is Neily on Nutrition. I'm with Karen Collins. She is the Nutrition Advisor for the American Institute for Cancer Research. I want to take the opportunity, because of her expertise in cancer, and you've been there how long?
Oh, over 25 years.
Over 25 years. Fantastic. Let's talk about some of the key things people need to know about that may be cancer-causing, and also maybe some of those myths that might be out there. For example, does sugar cause cancer?
Yeah, it's one of those things you hear a lot, sugar feeds cancer. Mm-hmm. And in the really technical sense, it does, because cancer cells, just like every cell, uses sugar for fuel. But that's talking about blood sugar.
Right, like glucose.
Right.
Yes.
So where people get mixed up is when they're thinking that every little bit of sugar that they might consume in their diet is not directly siphoned off to cancer cells. But what we know is that it's blood sugar, and the stronger driver is high levels of insulin.
Okay.
And when we can maintain a normal blood sugar and keep insulin levels good, that's the key.
Great. So, you know, the added sugar in the diet, not the healthiest for us, but it's not going to feed the cancer. Good message. Okay, red meat.
Yes, too much red meat does increase risk of colorectal cancer. A lot of people...
Just colorectal cancer?
That's the one that has the link right now.
Okay.
It's potential for others, but the link seems at this point to be the colorectal cancer, yeah. And a lot of people think that as long as they're choosing lean red meat, that they're protected. That's a guideline in terms of reducing risk of heart disease.
Right.
But the link of red meat to colorectal cancer does not seem to be anything to do with the fat content. It's the higher content of a form of iron called heme iron,
which
is a readily absorbable form. And it's good in the sense of meeting our iron needs, but too much poses some concerns, because it seems that these high levels of heme iron can form cancer-causing compounds within the gut and damage colon cells.
And recommendation for red meat per week?
No more than 18 ounces a week.
Right.
Problem.
It's, okay.
For people who want to eat it, it's, you know, some people choose not to eat it,
mm-hmm.
and that's fine.
Right.
But for people who want to eat it, it's not that they need to totally give it up.
Right.
We don't have that data.
Right.
What the data show is keep it no more than 18 ounces a week.
Okay. So we're taking that meat and we're grilling it. Let's talk about the char when you char grill.
Yeah, that is a problem. The char, that black substance, mm-hmm. is a really concentrated
good
source.
Part.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Rethink that message. No. It's a really concentrated dose of carcinogens in that char. Mm. So if you think of it that way, suddenly it doesn't taste so good.
Okay.
Now, you could still grill, but there's several steps you can take to make grilling safer. One is, aside from the char, that in the really intense heat, if you're grilling it on your, whether it's on a gas grill or charcoal grill, that doesn't make any difference. The risk is the same.
Mm-hmm.
It's that high temperature. So turn the grill, the gas grill down, let the charcoal grill cool down a little bit, and just cool enough, it'll take maybe another couple minutes, but in that lower temperature, fewer of these carcinogenic compounds called heterocyclic amines form. Other step.
Say that one 3 times.
Yeah, want me to? You want to have less smoking, because in the smoke is that concentration of another kind of carcinogen. So if you have less fatty meat that you're grilling, you don't have so much dripping on the coals, then you don't get so much smoke.
Exactly.
So kind of a multiple benefit.
Right. Yeah.
And the third thing is, if you marinate whatever it is, the meat or chicken or something like that, before you grill it, that actually has been found to decrease more than 90% of the heterocyclic amines that would otherwise form.
So marinating is a very good thing.
It is.
Okay. Good to know. Yes. Let's talk about a different kind of red meat in the processed meats and lunch meats, deli meats, things like that.
Yeah, processed meats are even more strongly associated with colorectal cancer risk than red meat is. And so the recommendation there is really to avoid it as much as you can, minimize the consumption.
Specifically?
And that would be, when we talk about processed meats, we're talking about meat that is smoked, salted, cured, or has added preservatives like nitrates or nitrates. And it's not a red or white thing, as far as we know, so the concern would be the same if it's turkey hot dogs or turkey bologna or something like that. And really the recommendation is just to minimize it as much as you can.
Okay. So bacon, sausage, find alternatives. What about like Canadian bacon?
Canadian bacon would be the same thing. It's leaner,
right,
but it's still cured. And it's that curing process, gotcha, curing and smoking that gets
so
us.
So ham as well?
Ham is too, right.
Okay.
So we want to think more about fresh meats, using chicken and turkey more.
Looking specifically for, I've seen like lunch meats or deli meats that are nitrite and nitrate free. Is that something to be looking for on a package?
Well, it could be better, but see, here's the problem.
Okay.
It's those four pieces that make something processed. So it might be nitrite-free bacon, but if it's still smoked, then you've still got these potential concerns from the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons that are coming from smoked food.
There's another one that just rolls off your tongue.
So really, it's minimizing that whole category and looking for fresher alternatives.
Okay. And organic. Not necessarily, when it comes to that, because organic food doesn't have anything to do with it if it's smoked or anything. So so someone's not necessarily safe if they're going organic.
It could be a health halo that it sounds really good, but it really comes down to looking for that salting, curing, smoking.
Okay.
And I think also, beginning to think more about roasted vegetable sandwiches. It doesn't always have to be the Dagwood sandwich with a pile of meat that high.
Right.
That you can look at what you've made for dinner and, think about other options of ways you can, make extra vegetables at dinner, and then what could you do with those for lunch. So there are a lot more options than what most of us think of just because we get stuck in a rut.
Right. So those are things, what people shouldn't do. What should they do to prevent risk of cancer? A plant-based diet, would that be?
Well, there's several different things, but the main pieces are a predominantly plant-based diet, which means focusing your meals around vegetables, fruits, whole grains, and beans.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean there's no room for animal foods
right.
if you want them,
mm-hmm.
but these foods should be the largest part of your meal. And we need to learn then to make them taste so good that we want to eat them a lot instead of having them be the thing that's just sort of sitting there.
Yeah.
So focusing on
those. I've got a great
those.
Video on roasting vegetables. Check it out.
Excellent.
With Robin Plotkin.
The other thing, though, to remember is sometimes we get so focused on the foods that we're eating that we forget that it matters how much we're eating.
Right.
So even if it's healthy food, if you're eating more than what you can burn up in activity and it's leading to an unhealthy weight, that's really not healthy eating.
Yeah.
Because what we're finding now is the research that is strongest in terms of nutrition's impact on cancer risk is how it affects your body composition and if you're carrying extra body fat.
Extra body weight, okay. Good to know. So sugar doesn't cause cancer. Red meat should be limited. Processed meat especially really should be avoided. And don't char your meats. Good stuff.
And love those veggies.
Eat those veggies. Eat a plant-powered diet.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Again, Karen Collins, Nutrition Advisor for the American Institute for Cancer Research. This is Neily on Nutrition, and we'll see you in the next video.